just kind of find weird stuff to play with, try to find where it relates to some piece of what we do for business. I'm not really good at sort of being a professional security guy, but as it says, I know how the PCs flow. I tend to be pretty good at looking at the security interface, the physical security interface, where embedded systems, when it comes to electricity, electrons, noise, RF, and stuff like that, get used. And most importantly, I'm not interested in hacking anything. If I'm going to answer stuff, I want to hack it more than things. So this means I don't want to just find a buffer overflow in something. I want to find an unpatchable, unfixable buffer overflow that no one can do anything about. And if I can't write anything, anyway, also, as it says, I'm a worker and a white paper. I'm not very good. I've tried cracking safes and things like that. I can't really crack safes the old fashioned way, listening to the stethoscope kind of way. But I thought this would be a really fun way to kind of put my stamp on white paper. So, without getting sort of too into the weeds, we're going to talk about some of the previous high security block designs and really how similar they are. And what I need to talk about, I've been working on is kind of a systemic flaw in pretty much every block designed by Kava, Amazes, to many other designs. We're going to talk about how the blocks kind of evolve from sort of point to point, sort of look at the security boundary as far as electrons go. I'm going to have some schematics up here. They're not really schematics. They may look like schematics. They're block diagrams. They're really just to kind of talk about where that security boundary is between lines. And then, of course, I'm going to whine about secure disclosure because everybody's whining. So, for these blocks, the most important things to know are kind of these bullet points. We're trying to make an electronic block, but I think that's exactly like the old block. You know, it places the old one exactly in the mechanical brass made machine thing. But we want to replace it with electrons and pixies because those are more secure. They have security. So, all the requirements we have here, they need to be long lived, we don't need batteries. But now that we're making electronic, we want tiered permission schemes, multiple users, time windows, all kinds of interesting things like that. And because of all of these things, these locks are going to be more secure, for sure. There's no real reason why, we've just made them electronic. So, this is your basic block design. If you're going to put something together with Arduino, this is probably what you do. You probably need an internal EEPROM, but whatever. You have an external EEPROM. You have some place to store the personality of the block, the actual individual stuff. You have a microcontroller that's got to do the interfacing with the real world. If I want to be long-lived, I've got to have something power the external loop. And you kind of see this little dotted line, and I'll use that in all my schematics to kind of show the privilege boundary of the block. So anything that's on the right-hand side of that dotted line is going to be something that's available to an attacker. Everything on the other side is theoretically inside the physically secured safe. Okay, so we've added some security to our design. We're basically doing the same thing that they did in smart cards, where we're trying to use the power line as our communication line. So we'll power ourselves off of that internal I/O line, store that capacitor, put a diode in there so you can't glitch me out, and call it over. That's what CyberLog. I'm just going to beat CyberLog over the head really quickly because I think it's interesting because every single one of their indoor cylinders were beatable with bullshit crypto. When I did the analysis, I can actually say, I love this little quote right here. It's kind of through this, the original advisory. You could probably extract the right key for power analysis, but I don't think it's worth the effort. This is the actual power trace that's in the report. You can actually see between A1 and A2 markers. There's kind of a little bit of a wiggle at the top of that line. And that's actually the microcontroller transferring its internal contents into the microcontroller as the block gets powered up externally. And that's pretty much our target for at least this presentation. So, you know, you've seen basic pluses and minuses, don't need batteries, have auto trails, have all those special security things. But of course, we start with bullshit crypto. We start with making it reliant on external power sources and basically the attacker provided power. And of course, we made sure that they couldn't be firmware updated or anything. So once they're in the door cylinders, every single door cylinder is going to be replaced. So this is kind of a little bit of a quick tangent. I'm not going to be on this too much. As a result of the CyberLog work, I got one of my, I want to say first, but just most recent DMCA cut your shit out letters. And I find it really annoying that working in electronic blocks, that this is the response that we get now. way, sort of, you know, 20 years ago, the idea of perfect security and the likelihood that a lock was going to be broken, at least was somewhat accepted. People were looking to try to figure out where the reality of that lock security is. But now with sort of the inherent approach of the software security in this area, we're starting to see the same sort of strategies for software security. Sue them, threaten them, claim it's not a problem. I'm okay with claiming it's not a problem, but sue them, threaten them, claim that they violated some sort of code of ethics by not going to the government first, which would be, you know, that kind of stuff is really starting to get going. That's why we're tangent on that. We'll put a pin in that and get back to that. There's another lock design that you start seeing that's a pretty common one. This is your standard home safe. This is kind of the thing that you might have in your hotel room, in fact. These locks have actually been pretty thoroughly beat. Anytime you have any sort of external power source, you just throw together some really shitty code, you're going to introduce tiny flaws, you're going to introduce some interesting power analysis. I think both these guys did some really good job. If Flora's out there, I own a beer somewhere. If Dave's out there, I probably own a beer, whatever I was trying to bring. I know that's terrible. But this lock design is pretty obvious, right? We have the battery on the outside. We know that we can measure the current flow from the battery. If you're going to stay with the battery, of course, I can measure the current flow from it. You also can be around, of course, I can reference myself to the current circuit. And, you know, we kind of learned these kind of designs are cheap. They're really easy to crank out there. You don't have to have software experts. You just throw it together really quick, but it's still like the external power and introduce these at least two side channels in this new design. I don't believe either of these lock designs have really done anything to update that. So, okay, what are we doing with these kinds of locks in other places? And this is where I get to my other quick tangent of things that I really enjoy working on. ATM. It turns out that ATMs also use the combination of safes. And there's another guy I know over here too. I really love this video. If you want to go look it up online, it's the greatest thing ever. He basically spends a full minute talking about how in the old days attackers would try to go through the safe door to steal money. Makes sense, going straight through this to get that money. But then goes on to explain how malware seems like a much more reasonable way to steal money these days. I figured, why not? Let's look at that lock. This thing is everywhere. And I did some work for a customer, and it turned out their ATM lab had every single ATM that had one of these locks on it. Didn't know how you could do it, they were until I started looking at them. So it turns out this lock design is typical. We have, you can't really tell the difference here between Gen 1 and Gen 2, but we have basically two different versions of the SEMCON, we have the Monicon, we've got just bank key stuff, these little tiny iButton devices that look at it, just looks like security. It's superficial. You gotta use your iButton and everything to get it. It's too hard of location. And this is more or less what you're looking at schematic wise. It's actually pretty interesting. Just to kind of go over really quick and dirty what the interesting bits are. We've got self-generating power, so there's no power now external to the safe. They're just bringing power in by generating this little knob. That's my terrible drawing now. The knob generates power internally. The lock has enough power, it'll boot up and happily display things on the LCD, and you can put the code and do things with it. But I can't directly measure the current flow here, right? The battery's on the inside. How do I even look at this? It turns out if you take the same approach, if you take the same approach and look at both of these, you know, power and ground lines, you more or less see a stable voltage, but if you AC bias that signal and take a look at the very tiny wiggles at the very top of that signal and amplify the fuck out of it, you end up getting that same side channel back, even though you're not drawing power from these insides. As it turns out that having power drawn from the outside of the safe is enough to kind of make that current flow variation work out. Just to get a little bit over it. These are kind of the insides of the safe, just so you can kind of get an idea of mechanically what they are. There's nothing too interesting going on with them. Here's the S2000 with the proof of concept button. The Auticon is very similar to the Generation 2. You can basically see they're almost clones except for some new features have been added. But you're looking at an 851 microcontroller in the case of the Auticon and the S2000. They don't even have the room for crypto with these things. Generation 2 is an SP430, and we'll talk about that a little bit. But digging through the patents for these locks, you kind of see that they didn't really have an idea of what security really meant when you're trying to deal with these internal neutrons. They basically talk about trying to mix and hide bits. the banking nodes by looking through the patents, but ultimately you're dealing with ending, ORing, exclusive ORing, nothing too fancy to generate a combination from the internal authentication data. This is basically what we're looking at in terms. So in this case, we're talking about the S2000 lock. We're getting a little bit into the actual attack that I'm going to show some concept for. And this is fairly consistent with all of the lock blocks. You have the parts of the EEPROM that the lock would read as it's trying to read its identity. You can see the second text line, the OX200 address starts with value 2 in the first case. So that's a shelling mode lock. And the other one below it is 05. That's a bank mode lock. Basically, these three authentication fields are all that make it up. It doesn't work. Everybody sort of focuses on the fact that I'm working on the simplest version of the lock configuration, but regardless of the lock configuration, it still has to read the same EEPROM contents, and these same EEPROM contents provide everything necessary for generating combination regardless of the mode. It might just be that, as you can see here, the high button is required to identify itself to the lock. You need to figure out what the IBUT number is, which is also stored in the external EEPROM. You can manipulate it with Arduino library. It's pretty straightforward. But as far as getting the power out, or as getting the actual data out, this is pretty much what we're looking at. This is the actual side channel, or at least one version of the side channel that we're looking at, along with the actual data that it represents. When we first looked at the lock, I thought I had this thing neat because we're looking at the soft I2C section, you just look at the first few bytes of that transfer. In this particular side channel, because it's an I2C, soft I2C, the edges between the clock and the data line are not perfectly aligned. So the timing signature between them is slightly offset, and then your data looks as though it's been Manchester coded. If you see three blips, you go transfers from 0 to 1, it's another three blips, you go transfers from 1 to 0. You dig a little bit further, it turns out I can't do that. That only works when the microcontroller talking to the EEPROM. If the EEPROM is talking back, those edges are simultaneous. But after spending a little bit of time filtering and sort of poking at it, it turns out that the ones are sort of preferentially linked on those high, sharp edges. Right? You can sort of see in both of these, it goes from 1 to 0 and 0 to 1, that clock edge, there's these high frequency spikes that sort of happen. Those high frequency spikes led to the gap. Very high frequency, they got lots of hard lines. There's a frequency they can leak out, they will. And that's how I wrote the first proof of concept, in fact. But because I had no faith in that actually working on stage here, I rewrote the proof of concept to work against sort of the lower frequency data set of the side channel. So in this case, you can actually line the bits of what the actual is actually the clock track of the data track. But then you have the power to trace aligned perfectly with that clock track. Can anyone tell me which ones are ones? Pick that up and put that by hand. So I think that's basically where I'll get to my proof of concept real quick, just to prove that I can actually do that automatically. But I don't think anybody should really focus on the idea that I can do it with an automated script, since this is basically what it looks like if you spend the time to align the traces, you extract that signal by hand. So let's see if we can pull this off by hand first. So as you can see, this is my S2000 here. I don't really have anything going on except Oscilloscope Rogue jammed in the data port, the actual IBUT port. If everything goes well, I'm going to get a single trace. I have to put the scope up with the lock a couple of times, but we'll just get a quick power trace. Yay, oscilloscope downloads. So once this downloads, we'll just run it through the little print box script. It already knows what the alignment for each of the edges of the square wave should be. And ultimately, what that is the actual concept code here. So what this guy is actually doing is, once we've gone in and find where the byte offsets are from the trigger point, we synchronize using the high frequency data from the actual lock itself. Sorry. Oh, we're not even seeing the download. Shoot. So this is the actual concept code that I call this. I can't see that. I'm bad at this. So these are the actual light offsets. We're using the high frequency to get the signal to actually create an alignment. So we just filter for everything above the light ring here to make some nice sharp spikes, use those smart sharp spikes to create a zero alignment. From that zero alignment, we calculate the light offsets from each light offset we have clock edge. And ultimately, what we're calculating is the difference in power consumption between the positive going clock edge and the negative going clock edge. If that rises above a certain threshold, then that was a one input transformer. This looks really dirty, so we'll give that a try. So this is the expected data that we would see internally, with this being the lock mode, and these three bytes actually being the shell mode combination. And you can see with the lock that it's in fact the shell mode with combination 11, 16, 33. And for whatever reason, it's in camp 7, I'm not sure. We're also going to miss a few bits here. Let's see if I can actually get this. Yeah, we miss a bit there. We're going to see there's a little bit of a spike in noise in our waveform. But you can pretty much always see when you lose this bit in the waveform. There's nothing too insane about sort of manually parsing. So the problem is creating a simple rule for how to threshold that bit out. It's not exactly easy. So don't concentrate too much on the fact of creating an automated sort of fix. So to me, to go back to the slide a little bit. Once the lock is actually loaded, you have these three authentication fields. All your actual sidechain attack has to do is extract what those three fields are, and from that point you can calculate for any of the generation one locks what the opening and closing codes for those safes should be. So as far as I'm concerned, any CENTCOM generation one safes that are actually in deployment are basically dead. They're not safe. Let's tell the case a little bit story-wise. When we reported this vulnerability to Kaba, there was a few things that happened. First, we found out that we reported them to the wrong Kaba. You'll laugh, but this is going to be a really funny detail. That guy Kaba was like, "Oh, great, you did some great work, really appreciate it. I'll pass this off to the other team that actually works on these locks." Said, we only make government locks. We make the XO9 series. So I googled the XO9 series and actually found some really interesting stuff. The XO9 series actually looks like it has a similar design to these CENTCOM locks. It's made almost identically, the same design pattern. We told him this meteor locks might also be affected by this design pattern issue. And he says, "You don't have the authority to test these locks." if you are doing any research on X10, the feds will be after you and whoever sold it to you. We then went off and notified our banking customers, and they said immediately, "Well, what about generation 2? There's a generation 2. So at the same time, I found about generation two, and I found out about the autocon, which is used in pharmaceuticals, weapon storage, anything you might want to have sort of on a trail for a number of people, maybe multiple people who are allowed to access that. The autocon just falls into this vulnerability. There's a master code. The master code is directly read from the EEPROM. So there's no banking mode or any digging around with any sort of high buttons or anything. You just put in the master code once you've extracted that, and have it open. Generation two, you can actually see the power trace. I can extract that shit. That's easy. It's loud. It makes lots of noise. But when I spent a little bit of time with it, it turns out that it actually does seem to try to use encryption internally to prevent you from pulling off this attack. So either they knew that this was a possibility, or they were just suspicious that it was a possibility. I'm going to put a pin in that one. You don't know what, let's get to that. And now, while I can't totally tell you about what happened with Gen 2, while I was getting my shit together for this presentation, I decided to go a little back through the Gen 2, rather than saying that, yeah, it might still be vulnerable to other side-channel attacks, power balances, or something like that, but at that point, if I've got any multiple traces, and I've got average traces and stuff, this is probably sufficiently secure for Windows. But in putting it together, I decided to see what would happen if I switched. You know what, I'm not going to say that. I decided to see what would happen if I did a little bit more poking at blocks. And in poking at the blocks, I discovered that the side channel does open them up to undocumented flaws. And if you can trigger some of these undocumented flaws, like the one that I have on the screen, you can look as much as you want in the SANCOM documentation for the Generation 2, you will find that. The blocks will happily reset themselves to factory condition, which means they have a combination of 50-25-50, and that's just pretty much that. So while the Gen 2 does defend itself against the sort of basic side channel attack that the Generation 1 went down to, the Generation 2 may in fact be more vulnerable in sort of differing ways. It's kind of fascinating. But you are probably, for the moment, somewhat safer with it. I don't know what to tell you. So we're done. Let's disclose this shit. Let's get to DEF CON. You guys would be happy with an ATM opening vulnerability, right? Like, that'd be good enough. But we kind of left this hanging thread of the DoD logs. So I got myself an XO7 first, because they're the oldest and cheapest, and you know, it's a hard bit of a lock. It's a hard bit of luck. This is going to be fun for one second. It actually denies me a lot of the electrical grounding and electrical signaling that the other locks sort of present because the keypad's things on the outside. Somebody has really sort of threat modeled the XO series of locks and not only designed them to be physically secure but also try to make them somewhat electronically secure. You can actually look at some images, but it kind of switched back and forth over the years on different design aspects of them. Where the generator sits on the inside or the outside of the lock, external where the attacker can get it, or inside where it's completely RF shielded. But before I talk about the XO series, a lot of you guys don't know what the XO series is. And because I am constantly shitting on people who FUD, I'm not gonna FUD. I'm just gonna play this video, which hopefully you guys can pick up here from. I mean, I love the CC list. The only thing that ruins is that sort of architecturally. This is what we're looking at with the, this is the exoskeleton, right? So we only have the knob that breaches through the actual safe body, and all we have is the LCD connector on the outside. This LCD connector, you know, it's, if you've ever driven an actual LCD, these signals are not anything that you consider friendly. There's no power, there's no ground, it's just sort of an AC signal. They don't bring any ground outside the safe that I can even measure these signals really against. Also, the locks are completely potted because they don't want you getting inside. By the way, you can remove this potting. We'll look at that a little bit also. But the further exos kind of shift the security boundary a little bit. They decide, let's put the generator on the outside of the lock. Still, I don't have ground. That seemed to be some consideration that they had not providing me that ground outside of the lock. So I really just had the AC signal from the generator knob and the AC signal from the actual LCD signal itself. This is, by the way, two depotted, the XO8 and the XO9 depotted and sort of wired up for testing. And yes, both of these are also E51 microcontrollers, so no room for gripping, nothing like anywhere near. Also, the internal EEPROM we've confirmed are just clear text. So just keep that in mind for similar AM tags. I hear a few people recognizing things. So if you actually look at these waveforms, you can kind of see why it's so hard to really, these are directly from the data sheet for the actual LCD driver chip that's inside these blocks. You can kind of see at any particular time, any LCD segment may have full VCC, negative VCC, half VCC, half negative VCC, or ground anywhere in there. And I'm trying to read this millivolt side channel out of there. And more or less, after I had the XO7, I kind of dropped it. I just left it alone for a while. And you have one of those shower thoughts moments that many space perfectly represents here, how to recover the side channel from that lock. You just separate the ones from the zero thing, separate the positive signals from the negative signals, and we have a thing for that. It's a bridge rectifier. But normally, we only use, you know, two poles of a bridge rectifier in your normal AC circuit. Turns out, you just make a bridge rectifier of 20. So, teeing off the LCD itself, and we're here, you can actually just set up a whole bunch of Schottky diodes. Tee the LCD out, and the LCD will still continue functioning as normal. But now I have a ground to reference the signal, the VCC signal from the LCD itself against, and now I can read that internal VCC signal. So let's see what we can find. So this top trace is the actual full VCC signal that you get off of the dial when twisting it. Keep in mind, I've got to keep the knob together and everything because you have to rotate that knob to power the lock. So the beginning spike, you see here at the ends of my mouse. This is the actual knob rotation time right here, and that's why you have these high-ish voltage spikes. And then suddenly right here is when the lock begins to get powered, and you can see it sort of slowly drawing from that internal voltage pool that it's got. And if we sort of zoom right in on this little spot right here, and take this little safety logic trace right here, that's a rather, we can actually see that we see these little high-frequency spikes of bullshit garbage that perfectly align up with the actual data transfers internally to the lock. Again, we know that the lock's internal EEPROM contents are not encrypted. If we bandpass that signal more and try to look a little bit closer, we can actually see the signal that we actually get is an inverted version of the actual data itself, just no more signal processing necessary. So I don't think you need to write, it might even be hard to write a private exploit for this to just sort of threshold these values out. But you can sort of see these two waveforms are inverted versions of each other. And that effectively allows me to extract the internal combination of the XO7, or the XO8, and the XO9. One of the things preventing you from doing this easily and stealing the nuclear codes is that the XO7, the XO8, the XO9, the X10 have some physical security aspects that make this somewhat difficult. You would have to remove, if you kind of see in this image here, I have to remove the front dial to actually get into the lock internals to do that. To do that, you would have to defeat this snap ring. And that snap ring is intended not to come out once it is firmly in place. But it turns out it's only that entire dial is really only kept on by a set screw. So if you drill through the front of the actual dial and put a screw in through there to thread that little hole, you can push the screw and back the entire knob off of the dial that goes through. That's not a non-destructive attack. You just drilled the knob to do this. But it's, you know, it's definitely a problem in the lock design. If you happen to bring a replacement knob, it would, you know, not leave any evidence. But I'm not going to claim that it's a non-destructive attack. So in slides that I had to add since Bullshit Reuters articles came out, we called Kyle back and, of course, we told him that, hey, so that lock you told me not to play with. I played with it totally wrong. And he was very snippy. He didn't actually tell me to go fuck myself, but between the... He told me that since the government is the only agency that receives the locks, they will be the ones to respond. He's also the guy this morning that questioned why I presented to a group of hackers or hobbyists or whatever rather than going to the government. I did, you dick, 10 months ago because of you. It's also worth pointing out that he actually alerted the government that we were doing what he tried to call the government on us. So we kind of went down this road because he was a dick. called the government back. They actually turned out to be a bunch of nice guys, but this was all happening during the government shutdown. they seemed to think this was important enough to fly out to our offices, which was one of the most awkward meetings that I have ever been in my life. You don't know awkward until you've been in a meeting with a guy who cannot spell the government without capitalizing the G. Not joking. And with a hacker who's trying to put a challenge accepted even in slide for them, so. But they turned out to be nice guys, and ultimately they went on to develop a mitigation for the XO series of blocks. They asked about the sign-on disclosure agreement. Pretty much everybody has asked me to sign on disclosure agreement for this, but I'm fucking done with blocks, so I'm going to DEFCON. This is how I can cathartically get rid of this entire line of research until someone shows me another bullshit. So we also decided that since it would potentially be a crime for me to purchase the X10 lock, and they seemed to warn me against buying it, even though they agreed that I should probably look at it, we kind of went our separate ways with them, sort of saying, you know, we'll go talk to some folks and we'll see whether or not it's worth you looking at the X10, but don't buy it. I decided to go look at the X10. The only thing that I can tell the X10 does is it had a backlight display. When we were contacted again by the GSA, this is the only quote that I have to say how the X10 security is. Alright, so I guess I actually got through 47 slides in 40 minutes. There may in fact be time